you will, direct your attention to our baptistry.
Good morning. All right, welcome to Greenbrier Road Baptist Church. I am Bradley, the youth guy, and if this is your first time here, we are honored that you chose to come here this morning to worship with us. In the pew in front of you, you're going to see a connection card, and we'd love it if you would fill that card out and drop in the offering plate as your gift to us. Just let us know that you are here, and we'd love to reach out to you with a card or a phone call just thanking you for being here. This morning, there was a Halloween party at the Wade's house, and my wife and I drove separate cars, and so as I was getting ready to leave, Bella says, "Dad, I want to ride with you." That's a little strange, because Bella typically chooses Jada over me all the time. And so as we were driving home, I knew Bella had been asking questions about God and had been saying things about Jesus, and so I sort of had this, you know, that kind of gnawing thought, you know, this is a good opportunity to talk to Belle about Jesus and maybe try to nail down some of those things. And so we pulled up in the driveway, and Bella at that point asked Jesus to come into her heart and to be her Savior. And so when I asked her if she had ever done that before, she goes, "Well, I've wanted to for a couple of months, but I just never have." And so as she told me that, then it hit me suddenly that there may be opportunities where somebody might be on the verge. And whereas we expect them to take the initiative, maybe sometimes it just takes us going, "Hey, what do you think about Jesus?" Or, you know, what do you think about this whole thing? And spurring that sometimes might lead them into making that decision. So, Bella, I'm going to ask you a couple of questions, and then we're going to baptize you. Did you ask Jesus to be the Lord of your life? Ask him to come into your heart. And do you know died today that you would go live with him forever in heaven? And if you promise to follow him for the rest of your life? Alright. Well, it's on that profession of faith that I baptize you, my Bella, my daughter, and now my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in new life.
I join with Bradley and welcome you this morning. We're so glad that you're here. I want to take this opportunity just to say that, and I pray that you'd feel right at home this morning if you're a guest. Would you pray with us? Father, we do love you, and we are so grateful for the opportunity that we have to gather together this morning. Father, it is a privilege to stand in a country where we still have the freedom of our religion. We get to meet and worship you and the freedom of that. And Lord, I just thank you for every man and woman who has stood and fought for that freedom. Lord, as we celebrate this weekend, Veterans Day, we are just indebted to so many that have given so much so that we could have the freedoms that we enjoy in this country. Lord, we are indebted to you being our Savior, because today, Lord, we see a testimony from Bella of how you have given your life, a great sacrifice, so that she could have eternal life. And many of us can relate to that because we've experienced that. Lord, I pray that today you'd be honored in everything that transpires in our midst, that, Lord, you would be the center and the focus of every bit of our attention this morning. Father, would you just receive all the worship and all the glory that you are due? Lord, for people who are in a crisis this morning, people who are struggling, God, with sin, or they're struggling with circumstances in their life, Lord, I pray that you would give them victory today through the power of Jesus. Lord, I just thank you again for this church and the ministry of this church into this community and around the world. Lord, use us today to glorify yourself, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
And as you will stand as we sing, "Because He Lives."
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love.
chorus again.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is.
He lives, I can face tomorrow. I'm so thankful this morning. You may be seated this time. Now, a man named by the name of DJ Rector is going to come and bring special music. DJ is a part of my D group at the BCM at Jacksonville State, and I've seen the Lord work in his life tremendously, and I'm looking forward to him sharing his heart with you through song now.
Myself at a loss of words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. In the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice, the word of God speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Myself at a loss of words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Amen. Thank you so much, DJ. In the book of 2 Timothy, Paul tells us that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and a sound mind. We are no longer slaves of fear. As we will stand as we sing, no longer slaves.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, until all my fears have gone and I'm no longer a slave. And let us sing our freedom. Now no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God.
With your head bowed and your eyes closed, maybe you're here today and you are still enslaved in fear. Maybe you've not found victory in Jesus Christ over the sins that entangle you. And even in this moment, we stand and sing a powerful song and we say we are no longer slaves to fear, but we are a child of God. But many of you may not could say that this morning. Would you come and give your life to Jesus Christ? Maybe you're here this morning and you are a child of God, but you still find yourself enslaved to fear and in bondage. Then I invite you even now, I'm going to invite Tyler to continue to lead us in singing. And in the quietness and the stillness of this moment in worship, I invite you to respond to Jesus Christ. He is here. His presence is in this, in our midst this morning. He doesn't want you to leave this place the same way you came in. Listen, don't leave a slave to anything other than Jesus Christ. Father, receive our worship as we continue in it.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here.
If you need to run to this altar, you come. Don't miss Jesus. He's here.
Without you, I fall apart. And you're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need every hour I need you, my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. 'Cause where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. Temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. You're my one defense. this. Oh God, how I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Lord, we thank you that you are our righteousness, and that all we need we find in you, and that God, you are our hope and our stay, and that Lord Jesus, nothing should bring us fear because we are overcomers in Christ. In this world, you tell us, we will have tribulation, but we can be of good cheer because you have overcome the world. Thank you, Jesus. Receive our time together as glory unto your name. In his name I pray, amen. You may be seated. Take your copy of God's Word, if you have your Bible this morning, and turn with me to the book of 1 John, the epistle of 1 John, chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, we'll start in verse 28 and move forward this morning. It is an exciting time as we journey through the book of 1 John and see a series that I've entitled The Basics. Godly living driven by eternal hope this morning is what I want us to focus on. Godly living driven by eternal hope. In other words, we live for Jesus because we have committed ourselves to him, and it's our and we find our hope in living for Jesus. We are driven to, because of our hope for eternal life, to live for God here on earth. We have been looking, and last week we looked at the deceptive characteristics of the Antichrist. We said that his spirit is among us in this world today, and he has an influence upon our world. We know and we recognize that the enemy is vicious. He is active in seeking to destroy followers of Jesus. He uses the temptations of the world to try to cause us to fall and try to ensnare us. But as John continues in his writing here in the book of 1 John, he continues his challenge to the churches of Asia Minor. And he says, here are some reasons, even despite or during these challenging times of last hours, that Satan is trying to destroy the work of God. Here is your hope. Here are reasons to hope. Maybe we could ask ourselves, what does hope mean? What does hope mean? Well, hope is a feeling of expectation and desire for certain things to happen. We have a feeling of expectation or desire for something to happen. We know that our hope is only found in Jesus Christ. There is no hope found in anything other, any person other than Jesus Christ. We live in a secular world that struggles to find real hope today, don't we? We live in a world that tries to find their hope in all these different avenues and opportunities that the world has to offer. We hear phrases like this, there is no hope, or we have no hope. We'll hear people say, well, there is no hope for that person. Or we say, I personally have no hope. But we live in a desire, or we live in a society where people desire to have genuine hope. They want to have hope. We want to have hope. We want to know that things are going to be okay and have an expectation or desire that certain things will happen in the future. But many people, even though they want to find hope, they search and search, and they can't find true hope. They can't find fulfillment in life. They search over and over through all kinds of temporal things, through drugs, through alcohol, through immoral relationships, through careers and hobbies and money and success and all these things. They try to find hope. They try to find peace. They try to find contentment. But what they realize is all those temporal things are just temporary. They really don't last. There's really no hope that can be found in the things of this world. Our hope is, the world is full of false hope, and our only hope is in Jesus Christ this morning. So I want to be clear. I want to give us some reasons that we can hope, or some reasons that we can be inspired to hope in Jesus Christ this morning. And I believe that's where John takes us this morning. I don't know about you, but I've often tried to find fulfillment and tried to find hope in things that are temporary. Even as a believer, I've been a believer since 1988, and even as a believer, there are times in my life where I've tried to find hope and trying to find things that would inspire my hope in other things. It seemed to be frequent in my life, even as your pastor, that I had struggled to find hope in things of this world, in the appreciation or in a satisfaction of people's words or people's encouragement. And if I'm not careful, I could find my hope and my fulfillment and my contentment in the fact that somebody else would say, Brad, you do a good job, or Brad, you've grown a big church, or Brad, you have a this, or you've done that. And if I wasn't careful in my life, I found myself finding my hope in something that was only of myself and not of God. Like I could build my own little world here and be successful and say, okay, well, I can hope in this. It makes me feel good. I find satisfaction in this. But as they say, I'm recovering from this thanks to some good people in my life. Thanks to some good people, I realized that success in my life is not found in what I can do, but in who Jesus is. I don't have to build up a reason to hope. I can hope in Jesus. I can find satisfaction in Jesus. And I felt a freedom like never before. I felt the love of God in my life like never before. I felt freedom like never before. I've grown in my relationship with God in a greater way in the past 3.5 years since I'm in recovery of this idea that I can find hope in something else, or I can find contentment in something else. There's a peace that comes across me. When I even talk about it, I'm like, wow, thank God I'm not who I was, but my hope is in Jesus Christ. My contentment is in Jesus. And I know maybe this makes some of you feel uncomfortable, because the pastor's standing up and saying, he's kind of confessing sin before us this morning. Listen, I'm a real guy. I just want you to understand it's okay to honestly reflect upon your life this morning. It's okay to honestly say, what is my hope found in today? Is my hope found in Jesus, only in Jesus? So here John is giving us some reasons to hope. Let's see what John has to say about this. Would you stand to honor the reading of God's word as we are together here in 1 John chapter 2, starting in verse 28. He says this, "And now, little children, abide in him, that when he appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him in his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who practices righteousness is born of him. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us, because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is, and everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure." May God bless the reading of his word as you're seated this morning. I see two words here that really jumped out at me when I began just to study and look into this text. I found two words that jumped out to me: confidence and hope. In verse 28, we see this word confidence. We can have confidence to stand before him when he appears. We have that drives our hope, a confidence. But also there in verse 3, it says, "And everyone who has this hope." There is a reason that we have as believers to hope in Jesus Christ. I want you to understand our hope is only found in eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. I'm going to be saying some other reasons that inspire our hope, but our hope is centered in Jesus. Let's not miss this. Our identity is found in who we are in Christ. Our hope for eternity is secure in him. So I want you to know that. You will not find it in any other way. So let's talk about some characteristics that inspire the believer's hope. First of all, number one, if you're taking notes, we can hope in our perseverance. We can hope. We have reason to hope. We are inspired to hope even more in our perseverance. Now, we can't just, I don't want to make sure I don't confuse anyone. Our hope is in Jesus, but because we persevere in Jesus, it gives us reason to hope even more. You understand what I'm saying here? So in verse 28, John says, "Little children, abide in him." Little children, he's not being offensive to the readers here. It's his way of saying people who are born of God, people who are in the family of God, God's children is what he's saying. He said, abide in him. This is not unfamiliar territory to those of us who've been here through the study of 1 John. John continuously says, abide in him. But when you see the word abide, you can also think of the word perseverance. John is telling us that our hope for Christ's return is found in our abiding and in our perseverance. We continue to persevere, and that can assure us and provide us hope that because we continue to persevere, that we're truly in Christ, that we truly have a relationship with Jesus Christ. The scriptures are clear that Jesus Christ alone secures our faith. In Romans chapter 8, he says, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us, that nothing shall separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And once we are truly saved, we're secure in this faith. God has secured it. So we can hope in our perseverance. Because we continue to persevere, it proves that we're genuinely followers of Christ, and we can hope for eternal life. Perseverance means this: steadfastness in doing something despite difficulty or delay in achieving success. Literally, to continue to press on in the midst of hardship. Some of you believers in this room continue to press on in midst of hardship after hardship after hardship, and you continue on because you are genuinely followers of Christ. And that can provide assurance to us. That inspires our reason to hope. John MacArthur says, no one who professes to believe the gospel but then permanently abandons the faith possesses eternal life. As I was reading on in John MacArthur, he said something like this: endurance in the faith is the evidence of genuine fellowship. Because we endure in the faith, it's evidence of our genuine fellowship, and therefore we have a reason to hope. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 12 says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, it says, work out your own salvation in fear and trembling. He goes on in the book of James. James says, for as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works also is dead. We continue to persevere. We continue to work out our salvation in fear and trembling. And because we continue to persevere in the midst of trouble, that can inspire our hope that is found in Jesus Christ. The second reason we can find hope is this: we can hope in our confidence in his appearing. We can hope in our confidence of his appearing. Notice what verse 28 says. Verse 28, it says, when he appears, and there's two kind of choices of what we will do when he appears. Now he's talking about the rapture of the church. When Jesus comes back for his church, John is getting his readers to reflect upon this day, and he's saying there's gonna come a day when Jesus comes back. There's coming a day when Jesus comes back. And he says, some of you are gonna have confidence in this day, and others of you are going to be fearful or ashamed in this day. You ever thought about what you're going to be like when Jesus comes back? You see, for those of us who have confidence in his appearing and not are ashamed in his appearing, this again is a reason that can inspire our hope. I'm the oldest of three boys. We're 3 years apart. 3 years and 3 months and 3 years and 3 months. So me and my youngest brother are six years apart, and my middle brother 3 years apart, obviously. And so there were times in our life where we had to come and stand before our father. You ever had those moments when you were growing up? Some of you remember those very vividly, don't you? You younger generation, y'all probably don't remember it as much as me, and then I don't remember it as much as some of you older than me, right? It seems like we got a little more, we backed off of that a little bit. But I remember days where there would be a lineup. My dad would say, Justin Brad, Micah Brett, and Zane Ryland, you need to get in here right now. Yes, sir. We go, we run in there, we hop in there, and we line up. And there was times when we knew that something had gone wrong, okay? We knew that something was adrift. Something was not right, because Dad would not call us, all three in at the same time, with our first and our middle names, just to say, hey, how are you doing? All right? There was something coming next, and so it never failed. Some of us would be able to appear in confidence. There was times I could show up and I could say, hey, I have confidence to show up that I did not do this. I did not do anything wrong. That is on one of these two right here. But there were other times that I showed up, and I showed up in a moment of shame. I was ashamed because I was standing before my father, and I knew there was something that I had done that had caused this crazy meeting right before supper that I wasn't going to look forward to. I remember one time that my dad called us all three in, and it was one of those moments of confidence. I came in, I don't even remember what it was, but it was one of those moments where my dad said, he asked us if we did something wrong. We went down the line, and I said no. My middle brother said no. My younger brother said no. So we all kind of stood there with some kind of confidence, I guess, in some way. And my dad said, well, I'll tell you what we're going to do until one of you tells us the truth. We are going to spank you one after the other until we get the truth out of you. Did anybody's parents ever do that? Just mine? Okay. But so anyways, we went through this process, and I knew I didn't do it. I knew I could stand with confidence, but over and over again, I took a whooping. I got spanked, and then we went down the line two times. And on the third time, I got smart. I was like, I did it. I did it. And my dad's like, no, you didn't. You didn't do it. I'm like, well, why are you spanking me if you know I didn't do it? Did y'all ever have one of those moments? Whew. So finally, my younger brother admitted, and he stood ashamed before my father telling the truth about what had happened. Listen to me. One day, we will all appear before our Father. We will all stand before Him, either in the judgment seat of Christ or in the great white throne judgment, and we will give an account for our life. We will have to stand before God. If you ask yourself, you can ask yourself this question, am I ready to stand before God today? Do I have confidence in standing before God like I did that day when I stood before my Father? I was confident I was good. I was confident I was not the reason for the meeting. Do you have confidence in this day that you'll stand before God? Or are you ashamed? Do you look in fear, with fear and trembling of the fact that you're going to stand before God one day? You see, we can hope in our confidence in His appearing. We have reason to hope in Jesus if we are confident in His second coming. And we stand before God one day. So that if you're taking notes, it's this: those who have confidence and those that will be ashamed. This confidence is a Greek word that means outspokenness or freedom to speak clearly. It would translate boldness to stand before Christ. Would you confidently stand before God today? Would you be able to confidently stand before Him? Listen, if you can say yes to that, then this is a reason that should inspire your hope for eternity. Our hope is in Jesus, but this inspires our hope. It continues to say, okay, yes, I'm where I need to be. God is ready to receive me. The third reason we have hope. We can have hope in our righteous living and our commitment to purity. Now listen, I want to stop here because I don't want us to journey down this path and you leave here confused that I preached something that I didn't preach. You are not saved by your works. You cannot do enough good to get to heaven. The Bible tells us it's by grace and through faith that you are saved. Is that not of yourself? It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. I want us to be very clear about that. But the Bible is also clear that when we are in Christ, we will be righteous people. Next week we're going to be together, that we're together, we're going to be talking about this. Sin, Christ, sin, and the believer is what we're going to be talking about. But listen, when we are in Christ, we are righteous people. And if we are living a righteous life, it can give us and inspire us as reasons to hope, to prove our faith. Say, what are you talking about? Well, the Bible says, Jesus was talking about in the Sermon on the Mount. He said, a good tree will bear good fruit, and a bad tree will bear bad fruit. In other words, there's evidence of your profession in how you follow after Christ. There's evidence of it. And that could provide us hope. John mentions this in two different verses. In verse 29, he says this, if you know that He is righteous, you know that everyone who practices righteousness is born of Him. What is he saying? You can find hope in your righteousness. Not that you're going to go to heaven because of your righteousness, but it gives you reason to inspire this hope in Christ. He goes on in verse 3, and he says, and everyone who has this hope in Him purifies himself just as He is pure. He says there's hope in the fact that you live a pure life. It proves your salvation. It inspires your hope. When you look at your spiritual life, are you driven to live for God? Is that the desire of your heart? Is that the desire that you would have to commit your life to Him? Because I think there's a lot of people who just go through the motions, right? There's a lot of people who just journey down a path toward that would say, hey, I'm righteous, look at me. But is that the genuine desire of your heart? Because there's a big difference I've learned in I have to do something and I get to do something. You ever thought about that? Listen, I don't live for Christ to check off a box so I can earn His approval by my righteousness. That's not at all it. I live for Jesus because that's the desire of my heart. It's a desire. I get to live for Jesus. I don't have to live for Jesus. right? There's a difference in how you equate these things. I get to read my Bible, or I have to read my Bible. There's a difference in that. I get to go to church, or I have to go to church. There's a difference in that. The difference is desire. Desire over obligation. One of my pastoral mentors, he's really helped me with this. He said, I quit using the phrase, I have to preach, or something like that. He says, I use the phrase, now I get to preach. So commonly we'll say, I have to preach next Sunday. No, he says, I get to preach next Sunday. It's a privilege. It's not a duty. It's something I desire to do. And so there's a big difference between desire. So we are not bound by legalistic duty, but we are loosed by a fervent desire for Jesus. This is a reason that we can hope. Genuine fellowship with God. The next thing, number four, he gives us a fourth reason that we can hope this morning. We can hope in God's initiative of love. We can hope in God's initiative of love. Look at verse 1 of chapter 3. John says, behold. What does that mean? Look. Listen. I've got something that's really important I'm about to say. That's what John's saying. He says, behold. Look at what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us that we should be called children of God. I offer to you that we have reason to hope when we think about the great magnitude that God loved us, that he loved us so much that he would send his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross, to be buried, to be resurrected, to turn his back upon his only Son on our behalf, to be raised again, to us to have victory over sin and victory over death. Listen, when we behold the great magnitude of love that Jesus has, that God has for us in sending Jesus, it should give us reason to hope that God was serious about this. God's serious. So John starts this verse 1 with a sense of wonder and amazement when he says, what manner, think about what manner. This phrasing is only used 7 times in the New Testament. We can find great hope for eternity in the fact that God initiated a great love toward us who are sinners. There's hope in this. Romans 5:8 is what I'm referring to when he says, but God demonstrates his own love toward us, and while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This gives us reason to hope. Think about this great love that God has for us, that he would give us such an expensive gift. I can't even equate to giving up my only child. I can't think about giving up one of my children. I can't even get that in my mind or fathom it, but the greatest love that I know how to share is with my wife and with my children, right? That's the greatest love that I know how to even compare it to. And I was thinking about this. I gave my wife an expensive gift, and she gave me an expensive gift when we got married. We gave ourselves. We gave all of ourselves to one another. 9 months before that, I gave her a ring that cost me several thousand dollars. It was probably the most expensive gift that I've ever given. Right? And it's crazy. Thousands of dollars for this ring to go on a finger, but what was it? It was not crazy. It was a desire that I had to show her that I loved her. And not only was I going to give her a ring, but 9 months later, I was going to give her everything that I had my whole life. I was serious about my love for my wife. I was serious about my commitment to marry her. I was so serious that I made a great investment. And we can find hope in this same kind of investment that God has made in us with Jesus. He's given us everything he has to reconcile us to himself. And the beautiful thing about it is, he doesn't treat us like outcasts. He doesn't, listen, the phrasing here is children. Behold, look at this, children of God. Child of God is what this phrasing John keeps giving us. He doesn't just make us outcast. He doesn't just give us some privilege of a family. He gives us complete privilege of the family, which is adoption into God's family. You are a child of God. This is reason to hope. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4 through 5 says, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us, it says, to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. We think about this adoption, this word adoption. I don't know about if y'all ever went through this in your life, but when I was a kid, I used to believe that I was adopted. Did anybody else struggle with that? I mean, I was serious about this. I really thought for a while there my mom and dad adopted me. I don't know why it bothered me so much, but it bothered me. And to the point that I got old enough, I made my mom get out the little fireproof safe that we had and show me my birth certificate, because I didn't believe her. You know, I mean, I should not look just like my dad in the face. Like, I mean, I should have known, like, this is real. Like, I really am, like, your child. And I don't know why I was fearful so much, because, listen, adoption is a beautiful picture. There are children that I've ministered to when I was in youth ministry that I never knew was adopted. Like, until someone told me, I thought they were, like, just the family. Why? Because they were treated in the same way as a child. They were loved. They were given every right and every privilege of being a part of the family. And I've learned as an adult, adoption is a beautiful thing. Listen, we've been adopted into the family of God, and our hope can be found in this adoption in Jesus. You are a child of God. It inspires our hope. And then John kind of closes and he says, we can hope in our process of sanctification. Look at verse 2, chapter 3, verse 2. He says, and everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure. That's verse 3. Look at verse 2. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. You know that old phrase, and I know you guys, I'll probably get an amen after this. I thank God from where I'm not where I've been, that I'm not where I used to be, that I'm where I am today, but I also thank God that I'm not today where I'm going to be down the road, right? I mean, the fact of the matter is God is still working on me. He's shaping me. He's molding me. He's making me into the person that he wants me to be. And some of you are like, amen. I hope he gets to working like double time on you, right? But this is the beautiful thing. We are in this process of sanctification. And if you look back at your life and say, I'm more like Jesus today than I used to be, then this is a good thing. And it's a reason to hope. It means that God is in your life and he's working and he's shaping and he's molding you. And you know what? You're not where you're going to be, because one day you're going to be like him. When we said, hey, we want to be, when we gave our life to Jesus, we said, we want to be Christian. What does that mean? Christ-like. You know what? You will never achieve Christ-likeness this side of heaven. But listen, when we get our glorified body, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. We can hope in this process. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18 says, but we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Let me ask you a question. Do these characteristics bring you hope today? Can you look forward to standing before God with confidence one day because you have a hope in Jesus and through Jesus that is inspired in these different qualities that John has brought out today? Is there a hope? Is there something you're looking forward to of being with Jesus? What is your hope built upon this morning? Do you have a reason to hope for eternity? Because there's many people that I encounter in this world that have no reason to hope for eternity. In fact, the most dreaded thing in their life is that one day this life will end, and then after that, they don't know what's going to happen. They have no hope. Listen to me. We need to be able to hope and know and have reason to hope in Jesus for what comes. That's why I love that old song, On Christ the Solid Rock I Stand. It's a song about hope. You can sing it with me if you know the words. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. How about the last verse? When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Can you hope in Jesus this morning? Is your hope founded upon Christ, the solid rock? Does your godly living inspire your hope? Can you look back and see evidence of a reason to hope this morning? Would you bow your head and close your eyes as we continue to ponder this and even respond to maybe how God has spoken to your heart this morning? There is hope that you can find in Jesus. You will not find it in this world. So are you ready to stand before God? Are you confident in His appearing, or are you going to be ashamed in His appearing this morning? Then I invite you to come and find confidence even today. Find hope. Something you can hope in today is Jesus, this Christ, the solid rock that we stand upon. So I'm going to pray now, and I'm going to pray that God would continue to speak into your heart from His Word. What reason do you have this morning to hope? Is it Jesus? Is it founded upon Jesus? Can you look back at this, these evidences or these characteristics that inspire that hope and say, yes, I am secure, like Romans 8 says, I'm secure. There's nothing that can separate me from the love of God. I have a hope in Christ that nothing can shake. And I want to pray for you. If you don't have that hope, you don't have that assurance, maybe you're putting your hope in things of this world. You're a believer, but listen, it's shaky at best. It leaves you unsatisfied and unfulfilled. Then I want to invite you to come and repent of sin and turn to Jesus. Whatever it is this morning, however you need to respond, I invite you to come. Father, would you just move? Would you work in majesty and in power in the lives and the hearts of each person that is present here today? God, maybe there are people still enslaved to fear, but yet they're a child of God. God, give them victory in Jesus. God, maybe there are people who are struggling to hope in Jesus today. God, would you give them hope that they can only find in Jesus? God, help them. Empower them. Because, Lord, I know you want the glory out of their life even this morning. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand to your feet as we have a time of response? You come. We'll receive you any way we can this morning as God leads.
Hope is built on nothing left than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus. Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord our Lord. Seems to hide its face. I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love, and through the storm he is Lord, Lord of all. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Amen. You may be seated. I invite our ushers to come forward at this time.
Freedoms that we enjoy. Thank you for the men and women that have served this country to ensure our freedoms. Thank you mostly for Jesus Christ. Take these tithes and offerings and use them for your glory. In Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Give a couple of announcements and do a recognition if I can. We'll start just by saying we sure do appreciate our veterans. If you've served in the armed forces in any way, would you just stand so we can honor you this morning? Just thank you for your commitment to our country. We owe you guys a debt that we cannot repay you. Thank you so much for all that you've done on behalf of our country. And our church just wanted to recognize you and tell you that we love you and we're thankful for that. And even the families that your families have been by your side through all that, we're so grateful for that. And what a wonderful time and weekend we've had to recognize that. And so we do honor your sacrifice in many ways. And we want to also make a few announcements this morning. We are packing boxes for our Operation Christmas Child tonight at 5 p.m. in the garden room. If we need to expand into the gym, we will. What we're asking you to do is to bring your boxes and bring your stuff. We'll pack them together. We'll pray over them, and then we will send you pray over them to send them out, okay? And so we're going to have a good time together. I was at Dollar General in Jacksonville last night. Dollar Tree. They still had lots of really cool stuff there. I don't know about having been to the other ones, but if you wait too long, you will not get them. So hurry to Dollar Tree if you want to help pack boxes. We hope you'll make that commitment. It's a great opportunity to help with your children, teach them about serving others and about giving gifts and Christmas to people who do not get gifts. And so we want to invite you to be here at 5 o'clock. Also, on November the 20th, that's next Sunday morning, as soon as our service is over, we'll have our Thanksgiving meal. And we want to invite you, and you can bring your extended family and friends. We'll have a church-wide Thanksgiving meal on the November the 20th. There's a sign-up list in the back, I believe, but the church is going to provide the meeting, the dressing. We pray that we asking that you would bring the side dish, drinks, and desserts. And so if you could help with that, that would be great. That's next Sunday night, next Sunday morning, as soon as the service is over. We will have no Sunday night activities through the holidays after tonight. Okay, so that will be our Sunday night activity that day as our meal. We have a baby shower for the McVeighs coming up next Sunday from 2 to 4. I invite you to be a part of that. And then we also, let's see, have a Lottie Moon announcement to make. We have set our goal for $2,500. We'll be receiving this offering all through the month of December, but specifically in an in gathering on December the 25th. And so if you want to go ahead and give to that, then you can do that. Or if you want to wait and do that on the 25th, what we find is if we're not careful, we spend all of our money. We have nothing to give on the 25th, right? So plan ahead now. Make your gift to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering a substantial gift that goes directly into ministry overseas and the missionaries that are serving there. All right. Well, I think that gets all of our announcements for today. I'm going to invite you to stand to your feet at this time. I'm going to ask if Nick Stevens would dismiss us.